In the last video, we have discussed about the sampling and quantization method. Now we will see representing of digital images. In order to understand representing digital images in various data structures, we need to understand one important term called as spatial domain. So before we get into this, we'll come back with the background. So we know that let f of st be a continuous image. A continuous image will be converted to a digital image by sampling and quantization, which we have discussed in the last video. Suppose this f of s comma t is being sampled into a 2D array. If it is being sampled to a 2D array, it will be like f of x comma y, where x has m number of rows and y has n number of columns. So what are the values that x might take? X takes 0, 1, 2 up to m minus 1, and y takes values 0, 1, 2 up to n minus 1. So these are discrete values. By knowing this x and y, if I put it onto a digital image, how does it look like? So now we have got f of xy. If I represent that using a digital image, how does it look like? It's a digital image. The corner coordinates will represent, this is 0, 0. The next value, f of 0, 1. So these coordinates I am going to identify by converting it to a digital image. That doesn't mean that these are the values which have been obtained by sampling. No, it's just a coordinates which have been verified. So this will represent your x and this represents your y. So generally, an image whichever we have been displayed in this way, it will be f of x comma y, when where these two are integer numbers. A section of a real plane is being panned over the spatial coordinates is called as a spatial domain. Getting it? Okay. So these coordinates, using these coordinates, if I am going to observe each and every value inside an image, that is due to the spatial coordinates of x and y, which are integers. Such type of images which have been put it on a 2D plane, such type of images we will call it as a spatial domain, and the coordinates are called as spatial coordinates. With this basic idea, we will understand the three ways of representing a digital image. The three ways of representing a digital images help us to come to a conclusion which one is the better way of representing a digital image and which one is not. It obviously gives us the way to think forward with respect to image processing as well. So the three ways, we will look into the benefits as well as the drawbacks of representing such images. Later, we will discuss about the density values. With respect to the density values, we will learn one more important term called dynamic range. We will understand about this dynamic range. When we understand about this dynamic range, it will help us to understand two important topics over there. One is saturation and another one is noise, which in turn will help us to understand the term contrast. So by starting with understanding what is a spatial domain, we will understand the three ways of representing a data structure. By understanding the spatial domain, We will try to understand the three ways of representing the digital image, its drawbacks and its own benefits. Then we will get back to the understanding the density levels if an image has been put on a 2D array. Then we will concentrate on the dynamic range, how a saturation noise and a contrast can be observed. And finally, we will look to what is the space required to store an image of different sizes. So these are the discussions we will start when we go back to our PowerPoint presentations. Fine. So we will start with three ways of representing a digital image with a PPT.
In a classroom explanation, I have given you an idea of a spatial domain. Now we will see the three basic ways to represent this f of xy, which is a spatial domain which we have got. Before that, I would like to put a light on why we take this x-axis and y-axis in a different way than the conventional way. Have a look here. The origin of a digital image is at the top left. That is the reason why we take our origin here. With the positive axis, we'll be extending towards bottom or downward, and positive y-axis extending to the right. This is conventional representation in televisions actually. A many image displays follow this technique, follow this representation actually. More important fact is that the first element of the matrix is by convention on at the top left of the array here. So choosing the origin f of xy at that point makes sense, right? With this, we will get to into how I can represent f of xy in three basic ways. Firstly, image plotted on a surface. Now you observe how this image has been plotted. Okay, there is an image here. With the surface, it has been projected, and you are able to see a symbol D being written here. How many axes you are able to see here? You are able to see three axes, correct? The two axes are representing the spatial location, this x and y. Got it or not? So, in what spatial domain this has been staying, that will be represented by this x and y, which is a spatial location. And the third axis which you are able to see, this f of xy, will represent the intensity. Okay, so this f of xy is a function of a variables x and y. So whether this is comfortable enough? See, the complex images are too detailed when we go for such type of representations. And interpretation will be difficult from these plots which is being shown here, x, y and f of xy. Whereas, they have their own benefits. The benefits is we can represent the images in with the grayscale sets whose elements are expressed as triplets x, y and z, because you have three axes, right? So that's the reason. So where x and y will show me the spatial coordinates, whereas z will show me the value of the coordinates x, y, right? Next, we will go for the second way of representation. In the second way, how it looks somewhere, something like this. And this is very common way of representing a digital image. Okay, so day-to-day activities, you see this. It's very, very commonly you can observe this. Okay, and you observe this is very similar to that of your photograph. Okay, it will be like a video. It is like just an image on your monitor, right? So this is very frequently used one. Here you observe there is only three intensities. Okay, and at the intensity at each every point, okay, is proportional to the value of that f of xy at that particular point of time. Okay, so here you are able to see only three equally spaced intensities. Okay, so those three intensities are black, totally black, gray, and white. If you take a value of this in the interval of 0 to 1, so the black represents 0, the gray represents 0.5, and white represents the value 1. A monitor or a printer, what it will do is, it will simply convert these values what I've told just now, like 0, 0.5, 1, directly to black, gray, and white. Now, we will go for the third representation. The third representation is simply a numerical values. So, before that, have a look on this. So, it is showing as a monitor or a photograph. It is three equally spaced intensity values, as I already told, 0, 0.5 and 1. Okay. Now, the third way. Third way is just a number representation. Numerical values, f of x, y, as an array of matrix I have represented. So this is a 0 black, 0.5 gray, 1 this is 1, 1 represents white. So in this example, what happens is, we are very much not clear of the image. It's just simply displaying the numbers, right? Okay, and it is very cumbersome. And the information, as I already told, we cannot convey, okay, this is what the image is all about. We cannot convey that. But the main strength of this representation is when you can design the algorithms here using this representation. While developing algorithms, you can use this. So before going to this, I would like to have a generalized representation here. So in a generalized representation, okay, so your f of xy can be represented as m cross n, a numerical array. Okay, so where x takes a value from 0 to n minus 1 and y takes a value from 0 to n minus 1. Okay, so your x values, if anyone asks, you can tell that your coordinate values of x are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 up to m minus 1. And y is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 up to n minus 1. Therefore, now whatever the images, whatever the values you get in that matrix is a pixel. That is the definition of your pixel. The each element in a matrix form is called as a pixel. It might also be called as an image element, picture element. Good enough? Okay. Now look at this image. Here, we have done sampling and quantization, which is a mathematical form of it. Now, let us assume Z and R are the two variables. Okay, Z and R are the two variables. The Z will represent set of integers and R will represent the set of real numbers. Okay, now what I'll do, I will make a sampling process here. When I make a sampling process, you know that it is just a XY plane on which a grid is being placed. And you will get the coordinate values. With the coordinates of each cell, the center value is a Cartesian product of these two. Okay, for this, what is the value? The Cartesian product of these two. Cartesian product of these two. Like this, you will get the values. And you know that x and y are integer numbers, then obviously the center value what you have been observing is also an integer. Therefore, f of x, y, we can call it as a digital image because x and y are integers and the intensity values to each distinct pair of coordinates. This functional assignment what we have seen just now was a quantization process which we have discussed. If this intensity levels are also integers, okay, now I have in the previous classes or previous videos we have seen that the integer values with respect to intensity we did not discuss. Suppose this intensity's values also became integers, what happens? It is a simple 2D image. This digitization process requires M, N and L, which are of a discrete intensity values. So m and n does not have restrictions. The only restriction of m and n is it should be a positive number, whereas l, it is a power of 2. With this, we will use one important term, a dynamic range. This dynamic range of an imaging system is to be a ratio, maximum measurable intensity to a minimum detectable intensity level in the system. Now observe this image. You are observing this image. You observe the focus, the light focus on this is very huge. You know the white value. What is the white value? White value is 255. So the image, the value which you are seeing here is more than 255. It is not so clear. We tell that this is very upper limit. We cannot determine it. This upper limit, we will call it as a saturation. Above this, we cannot see the image. It's just a blank white patch on that. Certain lower limits also do exist for images. Now observe here. Here. In this part. Okay. This lower image. What is happening here? We do not know. Because the intensity level is very low here. And we will call this as a noise. When we started discussing saturation and noise, we are closely getting associated with one important concept, that is contrast. Right? So, according to us, what is contrast? A contrast is just a difference in the intensity between highest and lowest values, between saturation and noise. With this basic, the number of bits required to store this digital image is given by B of m by n by k. Okay, so this m represents the coordinates of x, this n represents the coordinates of y, number of coordinates. It might be infinite also. Okay, so suppose the, if it is exactly the square image, then m will be equal to n. If m becomes equal to n, that will be called as n square of k. Similarly, for storing a 256 possible discrete intensity values, we will call that as an 8-bit image. To store that 8-bit image, the size will be of 1024 by 1024. Good enough? So, in this way, we represent digital images in three basic ways. We started understanding the image plotted as a surface, image displayed as a visual intensity array, as we see on our monitors and photographs. And lastly, we have seen how an image can be shown in a 2D numerical array.